Welcome, everybody. You just entered into the winning zone.
Winning zone. Winning zone.
Today, I will be taught the word of God. My mind is alert. My heart is receptive. I am ready to receive the incorruptible, indestructible, ever-living seed of the Word of God. I will never be the same. In Jesus' name, amen. You just entered into the winning zone.
Winning zone.
Winning zone.
Praise His name, praise His name.
Jesus.
Oh!
True God. Some people can say that there is this God and that God, but we know as believers there's only one true God, the Father God. Amen? Amen? Father God, we worship you today and we welcome you in our midst. We thank you, Lord, and we honor you, and we are so privileged to be called your children. Thank you for the plan of redemption for mankind. We are honored, Lord, that Jesus stayed on the cross. And that he saw us and he represented us on the cross. And everything that we will ever face, everything that will ever try to come against us, Lord, and things that are trying to right now, we thank you that it is finished because Jesus dealt with it on the cross. And we, Father, as your children here on the earth, we thank you for the assignments that you've given each and every one of us, that we are all prepared, we all have what we need. Help us to see that, to receive it, and walk in it. And Father, today as we worship you as a body, we thank you that you know what every individual needs, Father, concerning their life right now, whatever pain, whatever disappointments, whatever it is, Lord, we call on you and we receive what you have for us. And those that are viewing, Lord, we thank you that they hear the uncompromised word, Father, through the technology that you've provided. And Father, where people are, whether they're driving in their cars or laying in their beds in the hospital or in homes, wherever they may be, Lord, we thank you that the word goes forth unchecked and unhindered by any demon force. Lives are being changed today. People's hearts are being healed and mended. And those, Father, who once were blind are now seeing the goodness of the Lord. And it's because of your word, not because of us. Lord, we know that we're nothing without you and we're everything with you. And may they see that they're nothing without you, but they can be any and everything with you. And we are so blessed today, Lord, and we call you our daddy and our father. We thank you for ministering through our ministry gift today. As pastor comes, Lord, speak through his mouth. I thank you that he knows your voice and the voice of a stranger he'll not follow. Lives will be changed, people healed, set free, and delivered. We honor you today in the name of Jesus. And if you believe that, say amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Welcome to Summit Church. If you're here for the first time, we welcome you. We're so glad to have you. And if you are here because you are here more than once or whatever the time may be, you're always welcome. Amen. Amen. So, before I get going on just acknowledging you, I just want to give honor to Miss Kitty because, ha, that threw you off, right? You were not expecting that. I love it. So tomorrow's her birthday, and she, you know, we won't. Yay, 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 yay. And so for those of you that don't know, she's the wife of Minister Tracy, and I'm honoring her because they are just so faithful. And they've been with us from the very beginning in over 30-something years. And Miss Kitty, you're just, I love you. I appreciate you so much. Your faithfulness and, yes, your encouragement to me always. And so thank you for being who you are. I love you. And you are a bag of chips and everything else.
Thank
love
you.
You so much. Amen. So I'll let her tell you if she's going to say her age. That's none of my business. And but I just wanted to do that. And so, you know, and 30 is some change, right? You know, and there's a couple of things I just want to encourage us. And one of my assignments is, I like to motivate and encourage and inspire. And there's two things that minister to my heart this week, and I want to share them with you. And the one, you know, I was thinking about, You know, I love putting flowers out, but I'm not a gardener, but I love it, you know. And then from time to time, weeds come up, and you're like, dang it, you know, you thought you took care of that. But you know, weeds are really flowers. But what happens is they just show up in the wrong place. Doesn't mean that they're not needed or they're not beautiful, but they're not needed there, right? But weeds are still flowers. And so sometimes you might feel like a weed. That doesn't mean that you're not needed. It doesn't mean that you don't have what it takes. It just means you might be in the wrong location. And so just know that if you get plucked up somewhere or not where you think you should be, don't take that as you're not valuable. You are valuable, and you're needed. Amen? Amen? Amen. This one thing, this just blessed my heart. So, you know, the scripture talks about in 1 Peter 5, how the devil walks around like a roaring lion, seeking those who he may devour. And so, you know, it is said that if you ever come upon a lion, and I trust that me or you would never will, that don't run. Don't run, because the only thing that'll happen is you'll die tired. Okay? That's it. That's all that's going to happen, because a lion can run 50 miles an hour. But what it's said to do is you stop and you stare that lion right in the face. Because what he's doing first is he's doing a mock roar. And what the enemy does when he comes at us like a roaring lion, it's just a mock. He's trying to get us to lose our ground, to turn and run. But we don't run from the enemy. We stand our ground, and we look him right in the face, and you say, by Jesus' stripes, I'm healed. You say, I shall fulfill that which God has called me to do. Stand your ground. It's just a mock. It's just a smoke screen. We are who God says we are, and we can have what God says we can have. Do you receive that? Amen. Amen. I'll receive it too again. So praise God. So let's enter into another form of worship, and that's with our giving. We want to invite you to participate. We no longer pass the buckets. If you choose to participate in our worship time before service or even after or even now, if you'd like, you can take your envelopes and place them in our containers that's on the side of the, what's that? Sound booth. I'm going to get that booth a name, and it's going to stay the same. The sound booth. On each side of the sound booth, there are containers, and you are more than welcome to place your giving there. We are blessed to be a blessing, and God has been faithful over this pandemic. We've heard tremendous testimonies of what God has done in the midst of what seemed to be lack. But God provides. He is a provider. And so we're thankful, and we are just overwhelmed by all the goodness of the Lord. And so, Father, we just thank you today for your seed to us. We thank you for giving us seed to sow, bread for our food, multiplying our seed sown. Thank you, Lord, for meeting every need of every person. Thank you that the need of this ministry is met so that we continue to carry out vision. And we know, Lord, where there is vision, there is provision. We bless you today. We give you all the praise and thanksgiving. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Let's enter into some more worship in our with our music team. And Pastor's going to come and bless our hearts with the word of God. Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Before we do this last song, we're going to give a quick testimony. I have a friend of mine who's recovering from a stroke. And, he's been going through some challenges and getting things back, things coming back to his remembrance and that type of thing. And he keeps remembering the word and how he was first taught. And he's first taught in the King James. So we're walking through some verses and stuff. And he's asking me, where was that verse at and this verse at? So anyway, he's recovering. And this song, throughout the week, has kept bubbling over in my spirit. And it's while I'm waiting. And a lot of times when you think about waiting, you think of, well, I'm waiting on God to do something. And that's not what that waiting means. It doesn't mean that at all. That word waiting actually means to serve as in a waiter. So as you are serving and doing those things that you are supposed to do, then you are serving God. Mm-hmm. Applying the gifts that you've been given to the kingdom. Amen. You're not waiting on God to do something, because God did something. Jesus did things. He said the last three things he said before he left is, it is finished. Which means it's a done deal. You're not waiting to get something.
That's right.
You already have it. So continue to do what God has you to do and serving others. You're not doing it to get that, because he's already supplied it. And the enemy tries to tell you, if you don't do this, if you don't do that, or if you do this and you don't do that, then you haven't qualified. That's a lie. You didn't qualify yourself anyway.
That's right. Right.
The blood qualified you.
Yes, the blood.
So while you are waiting or serving, you're getting stronger. Your faith is rising, and you can run on. While you're waiting, you're lifted up on wings as eagles. I believe I can trust in you. Amen?
Amen.
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 Everybody say, oh, 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 oh. Come on and say, oh, oh, oh,
I believe I will trust.
Everybody say, oh, oh, oh,
oh, oh, oh,
come on and say, oh, oh, oh,
I believe I will trust in what my eyes can't see. I still believe everything spoken. I will run
and I will not be weary. I will run and I will not faint. I will rise upon wings as eagles.
I will run
and Hallelujah. Y'all believe what your eyes can't see? We see it by faith. Amen. We got another set of eyes. In our spirit, we believe. We trust. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. While we're waiting, waiting also means to minister to the Lord. As we minister to the Lord. You know, while you're waiting, that's something to do. Or ministering is what you do. Yes. Amen? Amen. And you get stronger. Yes. Amen? Amen. And you get more joy. I mean, it's in his presence. Yes. It's fullness of joy. Yes. Praise God. Y'all can be seated. Amen. Thank you, Lord. God is a good God. I'm so full today. Amen. I just want to also acknowledge Kitty White. She's one of the OGs. Her and Tracy. Amen. I don't even know how old she is. I don't really care. She's full of, her youth is being renewed like the eagles. Amen. Amen. She's always a blessing, always has a word of encouragement, always full of joy, and amen. She's just full all the time. Amen. Thank you, Lord. So we honor and appreciate her. I forgot to mention last week that it wasn't Sunday, but it was Wednesday, was my 40th year in ministry. 40 years to from the time I acknowledged my call to the ministry, and praise God. Doesn't seem like it. I was 2 years old, and I was at Lester Summerall's church at the 1981 camp meeting, and at 2 years old, my little hand went up in the air. Seriously, though, Kenneth Hagin was the speaker, and he spoke on the glory of God, and Lester Summerall, whose church hosted the camp meeting, he ran up to the podium after Brother Hagin ministered, and he said, there's 10 young men who's being called to the ministry. And then I don't remember putting my hand up. I looked up, and my hand was up in the air. And that's my testimony. Amen. And it just seems like yesterday. And I feel like I'm just getting started. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your faithfulness through the years. I say like Paul, thank God for putting me into the ministry. It's an honor to minister. So 40 years. 3 years later, almost 3 years, not quite, almost 3 years from that day in August 81 is when Summit was started. So Summit's not 40, Summit's 37. Okay, so that would have been 5 years old when I started Summit Church. I was a very young pastor. Amen. Tracy and Kitty was about six or seven. Amen. Amen. On a more serious note, but also a testimony, Haiti was hit with another earthquake, as some of you may have seen in the news. And Haiti is dear to my heart. I told them when I first went there, I just fell in love with the Haitians. And I told them when I ministered, I was there ministering at the Rhema Bible School there, the Rhema Bible Training Center in Haiti. And I've been there twice. And the first time they were recovering from the 2015 earthquake. And they're still recovering from that. And then they got hit with another one. And I told them when I first went there, that y'all need to make me I just made myself an honorary Haitian. So, and they're in my heart, and my heart goes out to them, to that country. So remember to pray for Haiti. And there's, a couple hundred, 200-300 people died the last that I looked. But a testimony in the midst of that is that all the people, we got a report from, and actually we support the Rhema Bible Training, well actually Ken and Tanya Taylor, who oversee that work in Haiti, and they're about to start a work, Rhema Bible Training Center in the Congo. And in the Congo, I forget the name of the city, it's the largest French-speaking city in the world. And most French-speaking people, I didn't know until I came in association with Ken and Tanya and John and Laura Madden, because they're called to the French-speaking part of the world. I didn't realize that most French-speaking people are people of color. And in Congo, it's the largest French-speaking people in the world. And there's some things that's going on, some crazy exciting things happening in the Congo. God has just opened the door wide open in the Congo. And the Rhema School is about to start, I believe, in September. And there's some things that they asked me not to share over social media. And we're on social media right now. So, but anyway, some exciting things are happening. And I'm going to have an opportunity to go. They want me to go and minister in the Congo, and I cannot wait. Can't wait. But back to the earthquake. Ken and Tanya oversee that school, and then the campus coordinators, Andy and Ruth Joseph, they were both, thank God, out of the country. I believe that was God's will for them to be. And God's plan for them to be out of the country when the earthquake hit. Actually, they are right now, I believe, still in the Congo, setting up for the upcoming school year in the Congo. But the praise report is that we got was none of the people that they're associated with, none of the students. They've got hundreds of students and graduates. Nobody got affected. Amen. No, there's no loss of life among them. And it's reminds me of Psalm 91, 1,000 may fall at our side and 10,000 at our right hand. And we don't rejoice in that. It's sad when we're not celebrating any loss of life, of course. But we've got a promise. Though 1,000 may fall at our side and 10,000 at our right hand, it shall not come near us. Amen. We just thank God for his protection. And we lay hold of his promises. See, we need to be like Gwen, my friend Gwen Myrie McLeod, and is that a new last name? I'm still getting used to it. Gwen, and she got this revelation from God that we need to be wide receivers. Wide receivers of God's blessings. Amen. And her and Connie have been running with that message. Praise God. All right. So let's just praise God for what he's doing in Haiti and in the Congo. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Thank you, Lord. Amen. Thank you, Lord, for what you're doing in those nations. And Father, we pray for Haiti right now. And we pray for restoration and those that have lost loved ones. Father, we pray for them. Father, we ask that you send laborers across their path to minister life to them, minister strength to them, minister comfort to them in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right. So we've got some cars, some tracks. There used to be tracks back in the day, boy, that would scare the hell out of people, man. They have like flames and showing people burning in hell and things like that. But that's not good news. And I believe there's a hell, but that's not the message that we hell is not the message we preach. We preach Jesus. Amen. It's not God's will that any should perish, but all come to repentance. Our message is not to scare the hell out of people. It's to preach the good news of Jesus and what he did for us in his finished work on the cross. So the first time I put the first track down, Shemaine went and grabbed him because he thought it, somebody else put that and it was the wrong thing. But it can throw you off when you read the first statement. Shemaine pulled. I said, no, put those back. It says, God loves you, but he's also mad at you. And then down at the bottom is hashtag stuff Jesus never said. And then on the back is some teaching. See, that's the mixed message in the church. He loves me, he loves me not. You know, he loves you, but then he's also pissed off. And that's not the gospel. You do bad, he loves you. You do good, he loves you. You do bad, he doesn't love you. It's like God in a swivel chair. It's like, all right, you're good today, I love you. You bad today, I love you not. You know, he turns back on you. That's not the message. And then in the back, so you can take some of these. Don't take a lot. We should have got some more made. Just take a couple and give them away and come back and replenish. We'll get some more. Here's, you can get your favorite. Here's one. Let's see. Similar to that, what I just said. He loves you, he loves you not. Stuff Jesus never said. And about his unchangeable love message on the back. Don't bother God with the small stuff. Stuff Jesus never said again, hashtag. I like that. Here's this might be my favorite. I'll say that one till last. You're not good enough. Now, strangely enough, this is some of the stuff that people preach. You're not good enough. Back is explanation on the back. God is good to you. All right. Here's one. You're a mistake. Breaks my heart when preachers, ministers, tell people. See? Even your mama and your daddy may have said you were an accident. You are not an accident. Amen. Hallelujah. So even if your parents didn't want you, didn't mean to have you, and there's a lot of ugly stuff that goes on in families and a lot of broken relationships between parents and children, and it's very sad. But you are not a mistake. I don't care what the circumstances were surrounding your birth. Before you were formed in the womb, he knew you. Amen. Thank you, Lord. On the back, God believes in you. This is my favorite. God is recording all your sins on video. Some people think when we get to heaven, he's going to run a tape, whatever the latest technology is in heaven. He's going to show you all the bad stuff you ever done. That'd be horrible. And with an audience, I mean, huh? But Jesus never said this kind of stuff. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Y'all ready for the word?
Yes.
Amen. I didn't get very far last week talking about the I wills of God. There's a whole lot of I wills in the Bible talking about what God will do for you, what God says himself that he will do for you. God wants to do for you.
Amen.
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 Thank you, Jesus. See, just to recap, this is one of the main statements from last week, and I want you to really get a hold of this. You need to know the difference between the covenants. The old covenant is a relationship with God that's based on what man had to do to qualify for God's blessings. The new covenant that we're under today, we're not under that covenant. The new covenant is a relationship with God that's based on what Jesus did to qualify you. Got it? Now, the Lord wants to bless us. And he really, this is a statement that's easy to look over. Jesus said, I didn't come to be served, watch this, but to serve. But the church, this could be on one of those cars, stuff Jesus never said. The church focuses on serving God. Now, this is going to sound crazy, but think about this statement. Jesus said it. I didn't make this up. He said, I didn't come to be served, but to serve. Let that sink in. The message of the church is, we need to serve God. You need to serve God. Look at all that God has done for you. We need to step it up. All that God has done for you, what are you doing for God? We need to serve him, serve him, serve him. But actually, that's not the message. That's not the gospel message. The gospel message is let him serve you. Let me give you some more stuff. Boy, this is good. Right after God gave the law in Exodus chapter 20, the Bible gives us the story in the very next chapter. The Bible gives us the story of the bond servant. Say what? I got a little sound effect when I do my lives now. I'm excited. Carla shakes her head at this. I got a little button. It says, say what? Yeah, I found the Ohio players back in the day. Some of y'all young folk don't know what I'm talking about. Amen. Sugarfoot. Come on, somebody. Say what? Huh? So I found that. I went and found that on YouTube, the acapella. And then I took that little clip out and added to my sound effect. Amen. But anyway, I'm talking about the bond servant. What is the bond servant? In Israel, what it's talking about, the law of the bond servant. So the bond servant at that time, every 7 years, he's like a slave. And every 7 years, they would allow the slaves to go free. They would allow the bond servant to go free if he wanted to. But if he loved his master treated him good, and he loved his master, he loved his wife, he loved his children, because he would have to go without them if he went free. But if he loved his master, he loved his wife, he loved his children, he could remain and be a servant forever. And if he chose to do that, they would pierce his ear. They would pierce his ear, and he would remain a servant forever. That is a picture of Jesus. Jesus came down to the earth. And it's interesting that that's right after he gave the law. Right after God gives us the law, the very next chapter, he gives us the law of the bondservant. You see, Jesus, that's a picture of Jesus. Jesus came to the earth, lived among us. He could have went back to heaven without us. But instead, he chose to go to the cross, to take our place, to die for us. Amen? And he was pierced in his side. Amen. His hands have the mark of his crucifixion. Praise God. Amen. And he redeemed us. See? And he's, where is he now? He's at the right hand of the Father. He's there to serve us. In fact, in Revelation, it says that, watch this, he has a golden girdle, even right now. See, a girdle, that golden girdle, it's a picture of service. Like when Jesus washed the disciples' feet, he girded himself and he served them by washing his feet. That's what that means when he girded himself. See, he took a towel and girded himself. He has a golden girdle in heaven. Let that sink in. It's a picture of service. And don't be like Peter when Jesus washed the disciples' feet. Don't have this religious attitude. Oh, Lord, you'll never wash my feet. That was Peter. See, because he has this religious attitude, this religious attitude. Oh, you're not going to serve me. And you know what Jesus told him? He said, you're going to have to, if you don't let me serve you, you'll have no share with me. He said, well, hey, wash my hands and my feet, my head and everything else. Huh? See, their religious attitude. Lord, you'll never serve me. No, he came not to be served, but to serve. Got it? Jesus wants to serve you. That should be our focus. Let him serve you. And of course we're going to serve him, but that's not the focus. It's just like it's not hearing his love. 1 John, not that we love God, but that he loved us. The focus is not loving God, serving God. The focus is letting him love you, letting him serve you. And when you do that, you're going to freely love him back. You're going to freely do what he has called you to do. Amen. You're going to do it with joy, not out of duty. Amen. He who is loved, loves. Amen. We love him and we love others as a reflex reaction to the love that he has for you. All right? So keep that in mind as we go through these scriptures about what God wants to do for you, what he has done for you. He said, I will, I will, I will. See, when it comes to healing, it's not a matter of God making up his mind on whether or not he wants to heal you. He already did it. Thank you, Lord. All right, let's dive right in, or we might not even finish today. Oh, I got to hit this preach button that starts my clock. They already started up there. They didn't realize I haven't started yet. All right, let's go over the scripture we looked at last week. But as it is, Hebrews chapter 8, verse 6, but as it is, Christ has obtained a ministry that is as much more, I love the much more is in the Bible. We can do a teaching on that, on the much mores. Like when the Bible says, you being evil or natural know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your heavenly Father give good things to those that ask him? See, if you don't read the Bible right, you think it's all about what you do for God. And that's looking at it from an old covenant mindset. But we need to read the Bible cross-eyed. Through the lens of the cross. Cross-eyed. Got it? All right. So read the Bible through the lens of the finished work of the cross. So we're in a better covenant right now. It's much more excellent, it says, much more excellent than the old, as the covenant he mediates is better, since it is enacted on better promises. For if that first covenant had been faultless, there would have been no occasion to look for a second. For he finds fault with them when he says, he found fault with the old covenant, not because there's anything wrong with it, but because we couldn't keep it. The old covenant, and we looked at this last week, and you can look it up, look up the message. It's on wherever you're watching right now, or Facebook, YouTube. And actually, you can go to iTunes and get the podcast, and you can get it for free. Praise God. So we went into this talking about how the law was never intended to make a man righteous. Okay? It was our tutor to bring us to Christ. It was to bring man to the end of himself so man can realize he can't keep it. He needs a Savior. Amen? Jesus was the only one who could keep the law perfectly, and he went to the cross on our behalf, took all of our sins, past, present, and future. Amen. I talked about last week how this thing is fixed. The covenant is between God and Jesus. All right, I'm getting ahead of myself, but anyway. He finds fault with them when he says, behold, the days are coming, declares the Lord, that when I will establish a new covenant. Say new covenant. New covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Next verse. Not like the covenant that I made with their fathers on the day when I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, for they did not continue in my covenant. Notice it's not like the covenant. That old covenant that he made with their fathers. See. All right, verse 10. And so I showed no concern for them, declares the Lord. For this, say this, this is the covenant that I will make. I will. This is, see, the old covenant again was about what man did. The new covenant is about what I will do, what God said I will do. I will make with the house of Israel after those days, declares the Lord. I will. Say, I will. I will put my laws, not the law, because he said this covenant is not like the old. And we told you last week what those laws are. So he puts these laws in our heart. They're hardwired into us. The law of love, the law of the spirit of life in Christ Jesus, the law of faith. See, not the old covenant law. He said, I will put my laws into their minds and write them on their hearts. I will be their God. Hold it. When God says, I will be, this is very important for you to understand. It's going to come up again. We're going to look at another passage. God wants us to get this. When he says, I will be your God, if you look that up and you follow that in the old covenant, you'll find that when God says, I will be your God, that means I'm going to be to you whatever you want me to be, whatever you need me to be. If you're sick, I will be your God means I will be your healer. If you're suffering lack, I will be your God means I will be your financier. Thank you, Jesus is right. Everybody say, thank you, Jesus. See, the new covenant is all about what God will do for you, and our response to all of this goodness is thank you, Jesus. I receive it and thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Be a wide receiver of God's blessings. I take it. Yes, you'll be my God. Amen. When you get threats on the job, I will be your God. And I'm going to make sure that no weapon formed against you shall prosper. He never said weapons won't be formed. They just won't work. Because you got the shield of faith up to extinguish every fiery dart of the wicked. I will. Not I might. I will. Man, you can take that to the bank. I will be your God. And they shall be my people. See what God is saying? You my people. My peoples. Huh? Amen? So nobody can mess with you. Your righteousness is of me, says the Lord. They belong to me. Like Hammer used to say, can't touch this. Doom, doo, 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 doo. We had the Ohio players up in here. We got Hammer. Never know who might show up in this message. And they shall not teach each one his neighbor and each one his brother, saying, know the Lord. For they all shall know me. Look at verse 11. See, in the new covenant, they all know me. Everybody, all of us have a relationship with God, not just the preacher. That's a whole other message, but a lot of people are still operating under the old covenant law. See, in the old covenant, only the prophet, priest, and king had the anointing, and they didn't even have the Spirit of God living in them. They just had an anointing that came on them to function in their office. And people would come to the priest to get a word from God. You don't have to do that today. That's the old covenant. You get your own word today. See, this is the covenant that I will make. It's already established. So it says in this new covenant, they shall not teach each one his neighbor and each one his brother, saying, know the Lord. For they all, that includes you, know me, from the least of them to the greatest. Oh, sookie, sookie. Now look at this one. Look at verse 12. I will be merciful toward their iniquities. Mercy is when you don't get what you deserve. Are you thankful? We don't deserve the blessings of God, but we got them because of Jesus. I will be merciful towards their iniquities, and I will remember their sins. And when they get to heaven, I'm going to play them on the video screen. No, I will remember their sins no more. How can he show you a picture or show a video of all your sins in heaven when he don't remember them? Hallelujah. You got a blank slate. Amen. We're living under the waterfall of God's forgiveness. Amen. As soon as you sin, it's washed away. Because of the finished work on the cross. He said, I will remember their sins no mas. No more. Glory to God. Hallelujah. Look at Hebrews 10. This is the same, in the same book. He's saying some of these same things again. This is the covenant that I will see. What are we talking about? The I wills of God. I will make. See, this is already established. And don't argue with people about it. Yeah, but. There ain't no yeah, but. See, the Bible never tells us to argue with anybody. Let me help you. Don't, when people try to dispute things that the Word clearly says and that God has shown you in the Word, that's why I encourage you, just don't take things because I say it. Make sure you see it in the Word. When you see it in the Word and you get a hold of it, forget it. You're too late to come tell me this don't work and this is not true. God has already established what I will do. You can't undo what God has done, and all your talking is not going to undo it. Amen. So don't let anybody rob you of your peace and get you all upset because they don't accept it. Because I tell you, sometimes people are just religious. They'll say amen to stuff, but then they act like they got to do something to earn God's blessings. There's no conditions here. He said, I made them. This is the covenant I will make with them after those days, declares the Lord. I will put my laws on their hearts. I talked about last week. How you know right from wrong. It's built into you. I will put my laws on their hearts and write them on their minds. Then he adds, here it is again, I will remember all your sins. And I'm recording them, so you better watch out. The boogeyman will get you if you don't watch out. God going to get you. God don't like ugly, and he going to come after you, and you keep on acting like that. See, this ungospel message has kept so many people away from the church. When I was deep in sin, yes, there is such thing as sin, and I was deep into it, far from the peaceful shore, as the old folks would say. There was a hymn about that. But sometimes when we would talk about and we weren't churchgoers, on occasion we would go. In college we would go because they served dinner after church or lunch after church, fried chicken, green beans stuff. And they would throw down too. Sometimes we would go just so we'd get that meal. It was free. Because in college we were hungry. Huh? Yep. So we would go to that church and eat. But sometimes when we would talk about going to church, and some of you may have heard this kind of talk. When you know you're not living right, and you look at each other and say, man, you better not go to that church. The lightning is going to strike when you hit that place. See, the church is the place where you need to come when you're all messed up. Hey, man. Thank you, Lord. So God said, I will remember their sins and lawless deeds no more. Churches needs to be a place where people can come and understand what God already did. He said, I will remember their sins no more. The ministry that we've been given, and it's very clear. If you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, it says that God was in Christ. Man, how do we miss this? Reconciling the world to himself through Jesus Christ. Not imputing their trespasses unto them. If you want to know what God is like, just look at Jesus. Did Jesus go around pointing out people's mistakes and faults? So where do we get this stuff from? This is religious. The people that gave Jesus all the trouble were religious folks. Don't he know that woman he's talking to is a sinner? I mean, Jesus had to correct him on many occasions. He's like, duh. Those that are well don't need the physician, but those that are sick. I've not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. But he didn't do it. See, and we misunderstood repentance. Repentance doesn't mean to come and snot and cry your brains out at the altar. Repent means to change your mind. And that's what Jesus was doing. He was changing minds. He was telling people how good God is. While religion goes and points out people's faults and tells them God's mad at them and God's got a big stick ready to clobber you the moment you do something wrong. That's not the good news. Is that what Jesus did? Y'all like Jesus? I mean, look at him. See what he did. So I'm not making this up. It sounds strange because religion has gone contrary to Jesus. It was the Pharisees, the Sadducees, and they were walking around with rocks in their jaws, upset at Jesus because he was showing mercy and compassion to people. You know, religious people are some of the meanest people you ever want to see. They always want to point out somebody's fault. That wasn't Jesus. Boy, they thought they had him with that woman caught in adultery, right? Yeah, yeah. We caught her in the act. The law said she ought to be stoned. What do you say? We won't get into that. See, so let's look at Hebrews chapter 6. Oh, my goodness, that's some small print up there on that screen. For when God made a promise to Abraham, since he had no one greater by whom to swear, I love this, he swore by himself. God's so bad, I mean bad in a good way, you know what I mean? God is like, I don't have nobody to swear by, so I'm just going to swear by myself. God's a bad dude, man. Man, one time God said, if I was hungry, I wouldn't tell you. The silver and gold are mine and the cattle on a thousand hills. Amen. Jesus was bad too. Pilate said, don't you know that I got power to crucify you and power to release you? Jesus like, dude, you have no power at all unless it was given to you from heaven. He said, I can call 12 legions of angels. There's 6,000 in a legion. He's talking about, I can call 72,000 angels to get me off this cross. One time he said, no man takes my life. I have the power to lay it down and power to take it back again. See, Jesus was no sissy. And see, this is what keep a lot of men out of the church. And people, you know, they see these pictures of Jesus. He looked like, man, he looked like he's soft. Man, Jesus was a man's man. Huh? He didn't have to go to the cross. But for the joy set before him, that was us, he laid down his life. He endured the cross. He despised the shame. Amen. He laid his life down. They couldn't take his life unless he gave it to them. He said, y'all, I'm letting you do this to me. Don't y'all see this? Y'all read the scripture. I come to redeem man. This is my mission. So when God could swear by no greater, he swore by himself, saying, surely I will, there's I will, bless you and multiply you. Glory to God. And see, when he made this promise to Abraham, I gave you that story last week. Y'all remember that? When God cut the covenant with Abraham, Jesus represented Abraham. Abraham was put asleep. And Jesus represented Abraham and cut the covenant with God. So the covenant is between God and Jesus. So man can't even mess it up. Verse 15, and thus Abraham, having patiently awaited, having patiently waited, obtained the promise. For people swear by something greater than themselves. And in all their disputes, an oath is final for confirmation. So when God desired to show more convincingly to the heirs of the promise the unchangeable character of his purpose, he guaranteed it with an oath. Ooh, hallelujah. So why does God even need to give us an oath, to give us a covenant oath? Shouldn't his word be enough? See, God's word is enough. He didn't even need to make an oath. The reason why he made an oath, you know why he made a covenant oath? To come down on our level. We're getting into some blood covenant teaching now. But he came down to our level because man needed it. So we have his word, and then he guaranteed his word with an oath. Verse 17. So when God desired to show, oh, I already read that. He guaranteed it with an oath. Verse 18. So that by two unchangeable things, and that was God and Jesus cutting the covenant, in which it is, watch this, impossible for God to lie. Number said, God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. Hath he said, and shall he not do it? Hath he spoken, and shall he not make it good? His word is enough. But he went a step further, came down on our level, and gave us an oath. See, the Bible is a covenant book. They understood covenant language. They understood blood covenant. And so, oh, he's giving us an oath. God really didn't need to do that. See, when man cuts a covenant, and if I cut a covenant with you, I may need an oath to hold me to it, to make sure I keep it. So I make an oath. God don't need that. When God said it, it's done. He will never go back on his word. It's impossible. Listen, it's impossible for him to lie. When God says something about you, forget it. I mean, it take it to the bank. All the promises of God, the Bible says, are yes. So be wide receivers of his promise. His word is enough. But then he guaranteed it with an oath. He said, I'm going to give you an oath on top of my word. And it is impossible, in which it is impossible for God to lie, as we who have fled for refuge might have strong encouragement. Doesn't that encourage you? Encourage you to do what? To hold fast to the hope set before us. Amen. What's hope? It's the confident expectation of good. Expect good things. Amen. God doesn't have nothing bad for you. He has only good stuff for you. Amen. Every good and perfect gift comes from above. From the Father of lights, James says, watch this, with whom there is no shadow of turning, no variation. God doesn't change slightly. You know what? I'm not even going to finish this today. Look at all these I wills. Look at 2 Corinthians 6. What agreement has the temple of God with idols? For we are the temple of the living God. I will make my dwelling among them and walk among them. and I will be their God. There it is again. I will be their God. Say, He will be my God. He said, I will. He ain't lying. Because it's impossible for him to lie. I will be their God, and they shall be my people. There it is again. We saw that before, right? Therefore, go out from their midst and be separate from them, says the Lord, and touch no unclean thing. Then I will welcome you, and I will be a father to you, and you shall be sons and daughters to me, says the Lord Almighty. Psalm 91. Ooh, wow. Because he holds fast to me in love, I will. Look at this, I will. I will deliver him. Not I might. You need deliverance? God said, I will deliver him. Thank you, Jesus. I will. Notice all these I wills in Psalm 91. I will protect him. Because he knows my name. When he calls to me, I might answer him. No, I will. Notice how many times I will is mentioned. If you got a highlighter or a pen, just highlight that or underline it in your Bible or digitally. Run your finger over it and highlight it. When he calls to me, God said, I will answer him. Thank you, Lord. You in trouble? He's right there with you in the trouble. I will be with him in trouble. I will rescue him and honor him with long... Oh, no, it doesn't say that. Does it say? Tomorrow's not promised to you. Watch out now. Y'all thought I stopped preaching. You ever heard anybody say that? Of course, you wouldn't say that. But you've heard people, tomorrow's not promised to you. Don't say that. What do you think this is? I'd receive it if I was you. Huh? See, some of y'all just repented. Pastor, I didn't see nobody down there in the altar crying and whining and snotting. Repent, remember what I said, repent means? It means to change your mind. Some of you thought tomorrow's not promised to you. Now you see a promise, with long life I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. If you say I received that, you just repented. See, repentance happens in this church all the time. Huh? Thank you, Lord. We found out that we're highly favored, right? That you're blessed, right? Ephesians 1:6. Man, I love that. Has blessed us in the beloved. The Greek word that's translated has blessed us is the same Greek word translated highly favored. Charito. When the angel appeared to Mary and said, Hail, highly favored one, concerning the coming of Jesus. Hail, highly favored one. So how are you? Are you blessed? Or are you... Come on now. Now, here's some people going to repent right here on this. Don't fall into, see, you got inside information. Don't fall into the stuff that the world says. How you doing? Fair to middling. What in the world? Tell me, what does that mean? I had to look it up. I heard that, like, huh? What does that even mean? I mean, I forgot even what it looked like. I mean, because I'm not even trying to remember that. fair to middling. And see, and some people wonder why I say the same stuff all the time. I'm like, what? Like, huh? How can you be fair to middling and highly favored at the same time? Am I misunderstanding what this word means? What does it mean? Well, I say fair to middling. What does that mean to you? Way to cook the steak. Well, come on, y'all. Don't act brand new right now. Y'all, anybody that's familiar, if you're not familiar with that, thank you, Lord. Huh? Huh? Average. Are you average? Are you just got, to me, it like kind of means you got your nose above the water. You just like tread water. You just like, I'm just above. I'm better than average, maybe just a little bit. I think that's what, when I looked it up, it's like I'm a little better than average. If I ever hear that again in church, I'm gonna slap the mess out of you. Now see, if you got something out of that, you just repented. Huh? You just repented. You changed your mind. See, y'all got wife saying stuff around me in church. Huh? Because you're going to be held accountable. Amen. Because I love you too much to keep you fair to middling, because it's a mixed message. Now, the same people, if you ask them if they're blessed, they'll say, yeah. Well, I thought you said you're fair to middling. Fair to middling. Goodness gracious. But you can pick up stuff that other people say, you know, and just mess yourself up, not think the way that God wants you to think. Amen? Thank you, Lord. You're not average. And we confess that. Y'all join the confessions. You'll see. I'm not average. Amen. I'm accepted and approved, not average, not mediocre. Huh? Holy, flawless, without blemish. Blameless, fair to middling. Amen. All right, thank you, Lord. Carla said, no condemnation. Amen, that's right, no condemnation. Oh, boy. I didn't even start my clock. What time is it? There's no way I can finish this. Amen. Give God praise today. Hallelujah. With long life, I will satisfy him and show him my salvation. Hallelujah. Amen. If you didn't get anything else out of this, you know you're not fair to middling. Amen. That kind of thinking, see, when you start thinking the way God, you're seeing yourself the way God sees you. You're not like everybody else. I mean, you're no better. I'm no better. You're no better. I'm no better than you. You're no better than me. We're as children of God, we're all in this, we're on the same place. Like, as a pastor, I don't have a higher place in God than you. See, that's an old covenant mindset. We all on the same level. The pastor and everybody else, we're on the same level in God. Well, I just need the man of God to put his hand on me so I can be blessed. You're already blessed. Now I can lay hands on you and things like that, but I don't need to do that in order for you to be anointed. You're already anointed. The Bible tells us that the anointing that we have received from God abides in you. You know you're anointed? I don't have any more anointing than you. Let that sink in. I don't have any more anointing than you. The ministers don't have a special Holy Spirit. We have the same Holy Spirit that you have. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for your word. Let's give God praise right now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you for what you said you will do for us. Well, heads are bowed and eyes are closed. If you never made Jesus the Lord of your life, I want to invite you to make him Lord today. On the cross, Jesus took every one of your sins, past, present, and future. And if you don't know him today, all you've got to do is accept what he did for you in his finished work on the cross. There's nothing you can do to earn it by grace. You've been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God. If you have to work for it, it's not a gift. It's not of works, lest any man should boast. Just receive what Jesus did. Just say yes to Jesus. So if you're here today and you never made Jesus Lord of your life, I want to invite you to pray this prayer. I want to lead you just in a simple prayer to receive Jesus as the Lord of your life. Say this with me. Say, dear God, I believe that you sent Jesus to die on a cross for me. I believe that you raised Jesus from the dead for me. And I receive all that Jesus did for me on the cross. Lord Jesus, I confess you right now as the Lord of my life. I receive you now as my Lord and Savior. In Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Oh, glory to God. If you prayed that prayer for the first time, I want to say welcome to the family of God. And what I'd like for you to do, if you prayed that prayer for the first time and you're here with us in person, if you prayed that prayer for the first time, just let me see your hand. Just hold your hand up. If you prayed that prayer for the first time, all right? If you have your hand up, you may put your hand down. If you prayed that prayer for the first time, we have a connection card in the seat backs. If you would check this box that says, I receive Jesus as my Lord and Savior, I want to give you something to help you understand what happened when you prayed that prayer and give you some information to help get your new life with the Lord off to a good start. You're a brand new person in Christ. If you just fill out that card, just check the box that I mentioned and give us your first name and email address. Drop it in the box. There's a box on either side of the sound booth back there. If you can just drop it in that slot, we'll get that information to you. If you're watching online, just message us your email address. If there's a number on your we don't do that anymore. Excuse me. I don't remember what you're supposed to do about that, but just message us. We got a new system, so I'm still getting used to it myself. So, but for sure, if you give us your email address, just message us your email address if you pray that prayer for the first time, and I'll get this information to you. Praise God. Hallelujah. All right. Let's give God praise one more time. Amen. Thank you, Jesus. Glory to God. I guess I could have ministered some more because I didn't even start my clock. I intended to, but all right, praise God. But we're going to let you out of here in just a little bit. I got some chicken and waffles waiting on me. Nashville hot chicken and waffles. But first, we got something more important. We're going to receive communion right now if you need communion elements. I'm going to take a poll one day to find out anybody who's taking communion every day at home, and I wonder how many people that's doing that have contracted COVID. Actually, I want to do that. I know the people that have been consistent on these confessions that we've been doing. I've been doing daily confessions for the past year, every Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, Friday. And Wednesday, we've got Bible study and prayer. So we're online twice. Since the pandemic, man, over a year, we've been on, how many days? 6 days a week. We've been broadcasting the good news 6 days a week since before the pandemic. On Facebook, YouTube. Amen. Man, I've been at this for 40 years. I feel like Caleb, I'm as strong today. I'm not old as he is, as he was. He was 85. He said, I'm as strong today as I was back then when I was 40. Love that kind of attitude, man. He's like, give me this mountain. Huh? I'm not trying to slow down. I want to challenge y'all. Some of y'all, need to keep up with me. Some of y'all been with me since the beginning. Don't start talking old. Had a Caleb kind of spirit. Oh, my memory not as good as it used to be. Stop it. Change your mind. Some of y'all repented today, didn't you? Amen. Amen. That's very important. I mean, when we get a different mindset and we're not fair to Midland no more, man, we've embraced that like a different mindset. You have no idea what they'll do for you. Amen. Glory to God, man. People that have been consistent this past year, they've been on making these confessing Psalm 91 every day. None of them contracted COVID. And I wonder, those of you I encourage you to take communion often. Amen. You don't need to have this, cute little cup and bread, just grab you some water or something. It don't take you long to do it. Just acknowledge it. That's the first thing I do in the morning. Amen. Somebody brought me a cup from Israel, but you have to have a cup from Israel. Amen. You should partake of communion, and I just thank him for the finished work on the cross. I did say different things, sometimes the same thing, but just like right now, Lord, just thank you. Just very simple. Thank you for taking every sickness and every disease, including COVID, on the cross for me. See, you're reinforcing that every time, and this is a covenant meal. And what if you believed this was stronger than the vaccine? I'm not telling you not to take a vaccine. Not here to do that. I'm here to tell you that this is stronger than, I believe that with all my heart. Now, if you didn't, and now you do, you just repented. We could call this message repenting today. See? Because I'm giving you something in the natural you can compare it to. Because when people take when people take vaccine, they're like, whether it's flu vaccine or whatever, I ain't getting no flu. What? I got the vaccine. huh? I don't care about this flu stuff going around. I got the flu vaccine. I got the COVID vaccine. See? What if we took this more seriously? Get out of your mind to some religious stuff. Oh, we have communion time. No. That's what Paul was dealing with the Corinthians. And they were just going around, and some of them was hungry, and they was grabbing. Man, they must have had a lot of food associated with communion. They just made it just a travesty, man. And they weren't acknowledging the power of it. And Paul had to address them. He said, don't y'all got houses you can eat in? When you come together, man, it's not for the Lord's Supper. Y'all tripping. Look how serious this is. This represents the Lord's body. His body was broken for our sicknesses and for our diseases. That's truth. He took COVID or he didn't. Amen. I mentioned this last week. You think, how many of you ever thought, any time since COVID happened, did anybody ever have the thought, I wonder, did Jesus got COVID? That tickled her. Amen. But that's right. As Jesus is, so am I. Thank you, Jesus, for taking every sickness. Thank you for taking COVID for me. By his wounds, I was healed. Amen. If I was healed, I am healed. If I am healed, I is healed. This cup represents the blood of Jesus. He took every single one of our sins, past, present, and future. We shouldn't even have sin on. Sin shouldn't even be on your radar. What did he do with your sin? He canceled them. We read it. He doesn't even remember them. So what you remembering them for? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus, for taking every one of our sins, past, present, and future, on the cross. Thank you that we're forgiven today. Thank you that we're children of God by faith in what you did for us on the cross. Amen. Let's partake of the cup. Amen. And here's Carla. Yeah.
Praise God. Wasn't that an awesome message? Wow. Praise God. Just a couple of things, and then Pastor's going to let us go. But so mark your calendar. If you aren't on Faith Life and you are a Summit member, you consider yourself a Summit member, please go and join Faith Life. And then you can get more information about how to do that back at Guest Services, because we're going to be celebrating his 40th ministry anniversary that Sunday, and it's going to be so special, and it's going to be wonderful.
What
and
Sunday?
We want you. Huh?
What Sunday?
September the 12th. Did I not say that? Okay, thank you. I got excited. So September the 12th. I said mark your calendar, didn't I? So mark your calendar for September the 12th, right? So, but what's going to happen even more exciting? The Indy Campus is going to join us live.
Oh, wow.
Woo! Yes, I'm so excited about that. So here's what's going to happen. So if you aren't going to be local, like live right here in the building, you don't have to RSVP, okay? So if you're going to stay at home and watch it, we welcome that. We would love to have as many as we can possible present. If you are going to be present, we're asking two things. If you are a Summit member, please join. If you consider yourself a Summit member, we're not asking for a certificate. We just said, if you say, this is my church, then sign up for Faith Life. Now, if you're not on social media, we get it. If you don't use technology at all, we get it. Then we will have a manual place back at the guest services where you can RSVP, okay? But don't be stubborn and say, I use my computer, but I'm not getting on Faith Life. Come on, guys. You're a member. Be a part of that.
Amen. We're encouraging community.
Yeah.
And so it can't be community without you.
Right.
We're paying for this platform for a reason.
Yeah.
Okay, because we don't want this to, this is not a teaching center where you just come in, get your teaching on Sunday and go. We want to have community. We want to pray with one another. We want to have praise reports where we can praise God with you.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah. So it's going to be really special, and we would love for all of you to come and be a part. Now, and you know, we will have a moment where if you want to share a testimony or just say something in regards to Pastor and how he has blessed your life with the word. So I'm going to encourage you to write it down because you'll be limited to your time. So we can't let anybody and everybody just go, right? So it's going to be a special moment. It's just a great, great service. So we're looking forward to that. And so mark your calendar, September the 12th at our 10 a.m. service. And you'll get to meet some of the Indy Campus people that are going to come and be with us. So
and we're going to have a Nashville hot chicken and waffles after
that
church.
That is not true. No, that will not happen. But we will have something for you, some refreshments afterwards. But, so, you know, that's a good reason, so we need you to RSVP. So so that being said, so be excited and come and join us, all right? Amen.
Amen. Stand up. Hallelujah. Say, I am.
I am.
Greatly blessed.
Greatly blessed.
Highly favored.
Highly favored.
Deeply loved.
Deeply loved.
And totally righteous.
Totally righteous.
And I'm destined to reign.
Because of Jesus.
Hallelujah.